Hey, welcome to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by Ogio Powersports and FMF Racing. I'm Don Maeda, and I'm joined today by GEICO Honda's Jeremy Martin. So, hey, bud, thanks for coming on today.
Yeah, stoked to be here and ready to have a good chat.
Yeah, so it's been a little while since I've seen you, or since anyone's seen you for that matter. You know, you're having a great year last year, and you had a pretty gnarly crash at Muddy Creek. So
yeah,
walk us through that, man. Like, do you remember what happened, or is it one of those crashes you don't remember?
Yeah, for sure. I remember it like it just happened. You know, we put a new clutch in. I wheelied a little bit off the line, and then I was a little bit kind of, I was definitely more mid-pack, made some really good passes, and then slid out exiting the turn. And then I was the furthest to the left, and I was like, dude, I got this. Like, everyone was to the right because the track's pretty slippery at Muddy Creek. It's real deceiving. And I was so far left, I'm like, dude, I'm not going to land on the landing. So I went a tiny bit right just to calculate for landing in a, you know what I mean, not off the track. So, yeah. And then I said it was too late. I was so focused on me, and he came over, and it was just game over. And then next thing you know, I was laying on the ground, and I was in a severe amount of pain. I couldn't move or nothing. So, and I knew that I was okay, wiggled my toes, and I knew obviously it was the back.
Yeah.
And then I got to the hospital, and I was like, dude, get some drugs in me. I probably went a good 30, 40 minutes because it was a lot, it was pretty painful.
Yeah. So it's crazy that in our sport, you know, you hit the ground, the first thing you do is you're like, wiggle your toes, wiggle your fingers, can I feel everything, right? But how bad or extensive was the back injury?
Yeah, it was really bad. Like, I tried to play it down at first just because it was so gnarly, and the sport of motocross is dangerous. We get that, right? And I'm all about like being a good ambassador for the sport and promoting the sport and getting young kids and stuff into riding. You know, ultimately that's what it's all about. And finally I came out a little bit later, but it was a burst fracture, and the doc goes, dude, you're lucky, dude. You should have bought a lotto ticket on the way in. And underwent the surgery. Unfortunately, he tried to do a 3 vertebrae fusion, was unsuccessful, so he went to 5. And then I woke up from surgery, I was told everything was good, obviously in some pain, and then we started to line up a medical jet to try to get back to Minnesota. And I remember just like, I was probably in Tennessee for 10 days, and I would just break out in like these gnarly sweats. And then I would get these chills and stuff, and we couldn't figure out why. And then come to find out, it was like it was a gnarly infection. It was a gram-negative infection, and
Where do you get that infection from, the hospital?
Yeah, just from the hospital, or just like, I was pretty dirty too from just I basically yard sailed, you know.
Yeah, they don't. I know the times that I've been injured at the track and taken in surgery. Like one time, I was like laying in the bed afterwards, and I like looked down, and my bloody jersey was still around my waist.
Yeah.
They don't really clean you up.
Yeah. I was pretty dirty. I remember like I still had some dirt on me and stuff, and I was just like, man, this is crazy. Like, you know, the longer you're open, the more susceptible you are to getting an infection, especially with a trauma like that in your back. And even the instrumentation that they put in, there's a chance that your body could reject it. So I've learned a lot the last year, but I went home and took that medical jet home and got cleaned up, and they went back in and cleaned me all up and got me on a, put a PICC line in, and I was there for about another 10 days or so, and then finally got to go home and sleep in my own bed.
Yeah. So a burst fracture, which vertebrae was it? Is it L,
it was
right?
L1, yeah.
L1. So when they say burst fracture, just disintegrated or like?
Yeah, so basically what happened was is I hit so hard that when on the rebound up, it just basically caused it to fracture and burst. It was just so much pressure that came down and then came back up that it just,
wow.
Which is gnarly because when you do a burst fracture like that, it kind of like, you know, pieces go everywhere, and obviously the spinal cord's right there, it gets to be pretty
tricky. Did you have any tingling or numbness?
No, like I was really, really fortunate and lucky that way, because the doctor says most people that have that type of injury sometimes have those after effects, you know?
Yeah, that's really, really lucky.
Yeah.
So when you say 5 vertebrae fusion, so it's the 2 above and 2 below?
Yeah.
Is it like, was it a cage or...?
It was just they were titanium bolts, actually. Like, I was blown away. And then a rod on each side of the spine, and then the screws going in. And, you know, and then it didn't heal right, just due to the way that the operation was done from the doctor. Mm-hmm. So we had to go and get it. I went and saw three different doctors in the process, and I went up to the Stedman Clinic, and then saw Dr. Corman, and he was like, dude, and this was 6 months in, the bone should have been fused by then. I should have been like getting ready to do rehab, and the plan was to do outdoors, and then it just didn't happen. So I had to go in for another operation, and yeah, he completely redid it, got a 3-vertebrae fusion, less hardware and everything like that. So I'll make 100% recovery, and then like I'll crash again, I'm sure, someday. But the good news is that it'll be good now, to where when I do take the hit, I'll be fine.
Yeah. So I know that there was GEICO announced that you're going to sit out this year just before the start of the 2019 season. Is that around the time that you found out that you needed a second surgery, or?
Yeah, well, I'd known a good amount of time before, and then it was just, I called my boss, and we were just like, dude, what do we do? How do we handle it, you know? And we decided to do it right around the team photo, when everyone's doing the photo shoots for the beginning of the year, and we got a plan together, and just kind of just went about it that way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you say boss, you're talking about Jeff?
Yeah, Jeff.
Yeah, Jeff Myshak. He's a really understanding.
Yeah, he's a great boss, and we have a good business relationship and a good personal friendship. So really understanding, and he gets that, you know, you have your highs and you have your lows in the sport, and they were willing to stick behind me, and they believe, so that's good.
Yeah. Well, okay, so two VITI national championships. You obviously have the credentials to show that you've got potential and future potential. So how is your contract worked out with them? Do you still have, were you under contract still this year and next, or?
Yep, I was under contract this year still, but we did a contract extension through 2020 and 2021.
Okay.
So I'll be with them in the 250 class a little bit longer. Ideally, you know, it would have been cool to go 450, but considering the circumstances and where things are at, 250 was the best option. And, you know, I'm not quite done yet. I still want to put my final touches in the 250 class before I go 450 and race the best guys in the world.
Yeah, you gotta get that supercross title, right?
Yeah, that's right.
So I was gonna ask about 450, how much you've ridden one, but you did one in Bercy when I was there last year, right?
Yeah.
Just a little bit, though.
Yep, I've raced. I mean, I practice on the 450 during the week, too, so it's not like a gnarly transition. The biggest thing is the 450 is heavier, and the torque of the power changes how the bike handles, too. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people just, like, try to get on it and pin it right away, or they take their setting from their 250 over to their 450, but it's a little bit different, and you got to know how to, like, set the bike up, and you've got to respect the 450. The thing's heavier, so you have to lean it earlier, and you have to do a couple things, like technique wise, just to account for the mass and of the bike and stuff.
Cool. Well, hey, we're gonna take a quick break to hear from our sponsors, and we'll be back for more with J-Mart. Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show, presented by Ogio and FNF Racing, joined by two-time national champion Jeremy Martin. So, you're on the sidelines, you're out for the whole season, basically. Are you watching the racing? How much are you staying in touch? Are you, like, Twittering and all that?
Yeah, definitely no Twittering, not much social media. I'm pretty a private person. I don't really care for any of that stuff. I just want to ideally ride my dirt bike fast, win races, and be a good person. So I've been watching them, though, and it's been a lot of good racing. Mm-hmm. Like the 450 class, Supercross, was pretty gnarly, and even the 250, like with AC going down, like right there at the end, dude, of the main, right? I was like, dang it, dude, because there's just a lot going in, a lot of pressure internally, but also from the team. Like when you've had a season like that and everything, and he's rebounded really well and just kept driving forward. So you got to give him credit for that. And yeah, I've just been doing my thing back in Minnesota.
Mm-hmm. Did you go to any races? Or you told me you went to Seattle earlier, right?
Yeah, I went to Seattle Supercross. Watched the racing, and I wanted to check out the city too because I'd never been there, and I'd heard a ton of good things about it. So toured that after the race for a couple days, which was really fun. And then I flew into Vegas to support the GEICO Honda team and everyone, and Chase winning the championship was a big deal. So that was pretty cool to see. And now I just saw the doctor about 2 weeks ago, and I got released to start training and start bending and doing some heavier physical therapy stuff. So it's been kind of just game on.
Yeah. Hey, so when they, you know, the fusion and all that, does it make you stiffer? Like, do you lose flexibility if your spine is fused?
Yeah. So when they spine when they fuse the spine like that, it from over those three vertebrae will grow together essentially as one bone.
Okay.
So like from the top and the bottom of the rods, it won't bend.
Mm-hmm.
Like from that point, so it's either above or below.
So when they took out the five and made it three, in theory, you'll gain more flexibility than you had before.
Yes,
right?
Oh, for sure. For sure. And if I would have had the five in there until it fused, I would have had another operation to get them taken out, because that's so much hardware. It puts a lot of tension above and below.
Yeah. I was at Jesse Nelson's house the other day, and he had his hardware taken out of his back. And I was like, dude, like the screws and the thing. And what's crazy is his cage, he put it back together. And it wasn't like it was like super Santa like this. It was like, you know, like every which way.
Yeah, it's crazy. Like I wanted to see my old hardware in my body, you know, and the rods were titanium. It was like different colored, you know, ones, bolts, and like the stuff that they have to like the screws are big. Like stuff you'd hang stuff up in the house with. Like I was like, holy crap.
Yeah, definitely. So what is the first steps of therapy then? Like what have you been able to do so far? Like nothing basically, or?
Yeah, so I haven't really done anything at all, and definitely probably the heaviest I've been in my life. Mm-hmm. So I'm like, I like to say I'm not heavy, I'm healthy.
Yeah, happy.
I'm happy right now. So, but that's good. I just started out walking. I had a goal, like I'd get up every day and I'd just walk 30 minutes, and then like I'd just slowly like increase up, and I've worked my way up. From there.
So what's the one thing you can't wait to do? I mean, besides motorcycle.
I just can't wait to just be fit to where I can just like dive headfirst into the pool, or be able to twist and not have to keep a rather straight, you know.
Yeah. Were you ever turtle shelled out? Did you have to wear that thing?
Yeah, I was turtle shelled out for a good 3 months.
Ooh.
And that thing was pretty uncomfortable, especially when I started to gain a little bit of weight.
Got tight?
Yeah, I got a little tight.
Now, I remember hearing a story that you were heavy when you were younger, right? And you said what was your nickname? Bubba Chubbs or something?
Yeah, I was real heavy when I was young, and they called me Bubba Chubbs and a whole host and list of other things.
Oh, it's a deep emotional scar, right? Because I was fat when I was little.
Yeah, for sure. It kind of sticks with you pretty good, I think. It's like, sounds like it did with you too. And you're just always self-conscious and you watch it.
Yeah, Bubba Chubbs. My nickname was Rotatus. It's courtesy of my big brother, Ross. But all right, so do you get to that point, like, you know, when you're injured like this and you can't work out, like, do you... For a guy that's been an elite athlete, that's learned to suffer and all that, like, do you miss that just suffering feeling of like,
yeah,
exercise?
For sure. I miss going out there every day and having that goal to which is to benefit myself and to get better every day. I think that's probably the hardest thing. Never once did I question whether or not I wanted to ride again or win races. I mean, I can't wait to get released to start riding my dirt bike, but I just miss like the deal of you wake up every day and everyone wakes up and they've got a goal and they've got a mission. And for me, that's to improve every day, physically, mentally, and on the dirt bike, you know? And then that's all of a sudden just gone.
Yeah.
And it's pretty tough to deal with. So I've learned a lot, like as far as dealing with that stuff mentally. I mean, I've taken a full season off. Mm-hmm. So I'm pretty sure I know what retirement's going to be like when I first quit.
So what have you been doing? Like, are you a gamer now or something? Or you reading a lot?
I gained for a little bit. I read a bunch of books. And then I just got to a point where like I'm like, dude, I can't sit inside anymore. Mm-hmm. And then everyone would go like, hey, I'm going to go for a bike ride or I'm going to go for a run. And I'd check in with my brother. And he's like, dude, I did like two 30s today. And I'm just like, you know,
just so killing you.
I ended up getting a job. Mm-hmm. Just to keep my mind busy and to give me something to do. And
so is that for real, the dealership thing?
Yeah.
You're working at a shop.
Yeah, I got a job. I was like, hey, I called up my buddy at Vice Cycle and I'm just like, hey, can you get me in like part-time? And I'll work from like 9 to 2 until my back gives out, you know? And he says, yeah, I'll hire you.
No way.
Yeah.
So a customer can go into this, it's a motorcycle dealer, right?
Well, he doesn't sell like dirt bikes and stuff there, but he does like service stuff. He sells gear, helmets, and all that
stuff.
Okay,
so a guy who's like a casual rider and a big fan can go in and he's like, oh, Jeremy Martin's working here.
Yeah, for sure. Like I'd answer the phone and I'd be like, hey, this is Vice Cycle. This is Jeremy speaking. And then I just like get whatever. If I couldn't help him, then I would just like pass a note on and then leave it for the boss and just have him deal with it.
Yeah, I saw I think there's a video on your Instagram, right, of you doing some stuff. I was like, oh, that stage, look at that.
Yeah, no, I legitimately did it. So, like, he'd have stuff, like, he sold, like, Troy Lee Design stuff and Fly and everything that would come in, he'd order in bulk. And then I would open the stuff up, price tag it, and then I'd organize the showroom floor. And I did it with chemicals and everything. And I did, like, they do Amazon stuff, too, so I get the packages in the morning, I'd open them, make sure everything was there, and then we'd get the labels ready to go and we'd ship the stuff out at the post office. So it was an eye-opening experience.
No way, that's so cool. Do customers freak out when they come in? Like,
a couple people like kind of double take, you know? And then kind of like what you said, they were like, dude, we thought it was staged.
Yeah.
When I posted the video and I was like, no, I'm here.
That's awesome. Have you had any irate, horrible customer experiences?
No, honestly, it was pretty good. And I never really dealt a whole lot with like that kind of stuff because I left it to the boss, but I was just there to help the daily works of the shop keep afloat.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, hey, we're going to take another quick break to hear from the people that make this show possible. Back for more with Jeremy Martin.
I've been with FXR for, you know, going on 4 years now. It's a small company starting out. It's growing really quickly, so it's nice to be a part of those guys.
Don't try to be the fastest on the track.
Be the fastest ever. Work harder than everyone else.
Because dedication is everything.
If they say your goals are crazy, be insane.
Be fast.
Be the crazy one.
Be unstoppable.
One goal, one vision.
We have 4 colors right now. Retails for $28.95 at odigrips.com and of course, your favorite retailer.
We put our heads together to both reimagine and lift the bar on what a modern motocross helmet should be. Opt for the highest level of modern technology and energy dispersion with the Fly Racing Formula helmet. Designed for an elevated defense against a wider range of real-world impact scenarios. Globally engineered with the most advanced materials and technologies available. Outfit yourself with proven technology, lightweight performance, and elevated impact management. with the Fly Racing Formula helmet.
Hey, welcome back to the Swapmoto Live Show presented by Ogio Powersports and FMF Racing. Again, I'm joined by Jeremy Martin, whose younger brother's still out there racing. Like, are you on him? Like, do you watch him and say, dude, why didn't you do this? Why didn't you do that? I mean, how close are you guys?
Yeah, I mean, obviously we're brothers, Alex and I, and he's actually the older one.
Oh, he's older?
Yeah, he's 29.
Okay. Yeah.
I'm 26 now,
okay.
So I'm getting up there too. But yeah, I watch him all the time, and I try to help as much as I can. He just switched to a new team, new bike and stuff. Yeah. So I think he's learned quite a bit, like kind of like what I first did with GEICO. It's he likes the bike, he loves the team. It's just about learning each other and learning how to set the bike up and how to, you know, like go about stuff that way.
Mm-hmm. What do you think of his riding so far this year?
I think it's good, but I think he could be a little bit better. Mm-hmm. Obviously he wants to be better too, but I mean, he got a second there at Hangtown, and he finally finished the Supercross season healthy, but like to see him get on the podium overall, for sure in the next couple of rounds. That'd be cool.
Yeah. Is he relocated to Charlotte?
No, he hasn't. So he has a place in Florida, and he trains there at the Nest.
Okay.
Or is it the Moto? What do they call it?
I don't know. They changed the name all the
time. Anyways.
Moto Sandbox?
Moto Sandbox?
I'm from California.
Yeah. But he's there, mainly located there, and then he goes to Charlotte to test.
Okay. So Nice. Yeah, that's a pretty crazy team. I mean, obviously, he probably told you about the shop, but have you been to the JGR shop?
No.
To visit him or something?
I've never been, but I've heard it's pretty insane.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like the NASCAR equivalent of what the GEICO shop is in Corona.
Wow.
I mean, I took Anton there for the first time the other day, and he was freaked out about how big the GEICO race shop is.
Yeah, the first time I walked in the GEICO shop, I'm like, these guys aren't messing around. I mean, it's a serious operation, and they have everything you need in-house to get the job done.
The gym upstairs and everything.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So when you get back, how much time are you going to give before you get back on your bicycle? Because I think you'll be happy to know your KOM on Bedford still stands.
Yeah, no, that's good. I love it, dude. I miss Strava, and I've got quite a few KOMs.
Yeah.
The goal is, obviously, I'm nowhere near as fit as I once was, but we're going to get back there and get back to winning races and running for championships.
Yeah. What are you, okay, so the timeline is you're allowed to start training and stuff right now, right?
Mm-hmm.
So what's the goal for, like, when do you want to get back on a motorcycle?
Yeah, so originally it was kind of looking like September, October would be the first time I'd ride a dirt bike, but I'm actually ahead of the curve right now. I'm healing faster than the doctor anticipated, now that it was done, the operation was done right. So I see him August 13th, so I'm just counting down the days, but if everything's good and he's stoked on it, we'll probably start riding after that.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, so you will have plenty of time to get ready for Anaheim 1 2020 then.
Yeah, I'm ready to get ready. Good solid couple of months, really, of good base training. And the biggest thing is like, I'm at rock bottom right now because I sat in that brace, and so I have no core. I have no, like, you know, they cut the spine, the muscles in the back. So it's all about just baby steps and building the body up to where I can train aggressively, pretty much.
Okay, so you came, well, maybe not really close, but I mean, you broke your back, right? And that's like, I'd say, aside from like dying on a motorcycle, like it's the biggest fear of most people that race and ride, you know, like breaking your back and becoming paralyzed. But like, Did that ever sink in or cause you to think like, man, do I want to do this? I mean, I know you said earlier it was never a doubt, but did that severity of the injury ever weigh heavily on you?
I mean, I thought about it. Like you said, for sure, I think every racer's really kind of worst fear is to break the back, just because of what the consequences come with it, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, I'm pretty mentally strong for sure. I thought about it, and I even went out and got that part-time job just to like, just to make sure.
Check on real life.
And like, honestly, I thought to myself, I'm like, dude, you've come so far and you've been through so much that, you know, you can't throw in the towel now. I mean, now's the time in your life where you've got a great opportunity to really tell one hell of a story. Mm-hmm. And you can either give up or you can just accept what's happened. And you can put everything that you have and more into going forward and being the best racer you can be and win, and then and be one heck of an ambassador, and and it's a heck of a story.
Yeah.
So that's kind of where I'm at right now, is just ready to win races and get back to doing what I love and working with good people.
Yeah. Will you wear anything different when you come back? Like, will you like wear more protective gear? Like, it's kind of funny how like a lot of kids grow up wearing chest protectors, right? And then they turn pro and they're out the door. But
yeah,
I'm not shaming on anyone for that or anything, because I don't wear one myself either. But will protecting yourself be more front of mind, or is it just business as usual?
I think it's pretty much just business as usual. I mean, I wore an under protector, and I always took the back off. Mm-hmm. I'll probably wear the back part, but that's about it.
Yeah.
Just to help protect it a little bit. I mean, I didn't have it on a couple of years ago, and I broke some ribs in 2016. Mm-hmm. My last year on Star, an AC caught me with a foot peg. So it...
I remember that.
Yeah, broke some ribs, and I think had I had that back brace on, it probably would have protected me.
Yeah. So, okay, you're going to start riding in August, be back for Supercross. Two more years in the 2VD class then?
Yep, two more years in the 2VD class, and then 450.
Yeah. I mean, are you pumped for that, like the 450?
Oh, I'm beyond excited. I mean, it's every kid's dream. Like, I've been fortunate enough to win two championships in the outdoor series. Mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to trying to get a Supercross title and some more outdoor titles. But, dude, let's be honest. Like, when you win a 450, if you get a chance to go 450, like what I did for Daytona in 2017, mm-hmm. I'm like, dude, I was on the line and I'm like, this is bad. Like, dude, I'm racing the best of the best. Like, yeah. Let's go to town and let's rip a hole shot and let's go race, you know? So that's what it's all about.
Yeah. Do you think Alex is ever going to get a 250 or a 450? I mean, what do you say? He's 29 right now, 28?
He's 29, yeah.
29.
I mean, I think he would love to have the opportunity, but a lot of people don't understand is that the 450 rides are getting harder and harder to come by.
Definitely.
And the 250 teams, they want results too. And you can stay in the 250 class and hire a veteran, and you know, you can make money or you can go 450, and it's just those rides aren't there. Mm-hmm. It's four guys in a light and a 2VD class, and there's two guys in a 450.
Yeah. Hey, what is the missing ingredient for you? Why don't you have that 2VD Supercross title yet? Because your national titles, you just came out and kicked everybody's ass. So is it obviously a different style of riding, but I mean, what were you lacking?
Yeah, for sure. And that's something that I've really realized from taking this break, is that basically it wasn't that I was lacking speed. It was just the consistency of the starts. Mm-hmm. I mean, in outdoors, you have 30 plus two motos. It's hot to make up for a mistake. Yeah. In Supercross, we're all closer. You don't have to be as fit. You can rely more off natural talent. And I mean, like Webb is a prime example. Dude's amazingly talented. He was ripping hole shots all year. Mm-hmm. And he was extremely consistent, and I think that shows. It was like a Dungy type deal.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Well, hey, we are unfortunately out of time, but man, it was awesome having you on the show, and look forward to seeing you at the track. I mean, because you'll probably come out to California to do some testing and all that stuff when you get ready. But yeah, wishing you the best in recovery and therapy and exercise.
And
losing the Bubba Chubbs. Yeah. But hey, give even though you don't like social media, your handle on Instagram is?
JeremyMartin6.
Six, no underscore, nothing, right?
No.
JeremyMartin6. If you like the show, please like and subscribe to our YouTube channel. And of course, check swapmotolive.com. Thanks for watching.